In this episode of Lowbug Garage, this was broken, this was broken, this didn't work, and then this happened. In the first part of this series, we flew to the East Coast to pick up a 1953 Kenworth Pacific bus and started heading across the country with it, but only made it halfway. In the next video, we made it the rest of the way, found some problems, I started fixing what I could, and ordered some new parts. Now that I've got some parts in, I'm going to start doing some more fixing.
This is a rooftop air conditioner. I bought the biggest one I could get, 15,000 BTU. Because I think that thing's going to be pretty warm. It was a pretty big splurge, but I think that'll make it a lot nicer and be worth it in the end. Now the only question I have is how do I get that roof unit up there?
Another problem I'm going to run into mounting this roof here is the roof is curved, and those are meant for being on a flat roof. I pop the escape hatch, we actually see the curve of the roof. This piece of square tubing is the exact length of the gasket, so I can make up something that fills that gap before I set that on the roof. That looks like around a half inch. That's not too bad. Now, another one of my only concerns is power. Shore power with a cord or the generator would easily power the AC, but I want to be able to use this while we drive, which means the cord is right out. The generator is possible, but I'd rather not run it while we drive. I want to look into another option. Now, this bus already has this big inverter installed and a dedicated alternator running off the engine. That's going to take a lot of battery juice to handle the startup power, and then after the compressor starts, I think the engine alternator will handle it. But it means I need batteries.
I got some pretty good battery power here. I just got a deal on some really close to new batteries out of a lowrider.
Now, he bought 8 of these Continental Group 31 batteries to fit in the trunk of a 63 Chevy, and his intention was to run a 96-volt hydraulic pump to really make the thing hop around.
But then there was a fitment issue, and he couldn't actually put all 8 batteries in the trunk, which means I have batteries that are only 2 months old that have barely even been used. I don't even know if he hooked them up. But before I install them, they're going to help me put in this air conditioner. Let me show you how that's going to happen. Now, I'm going to need help installing that air conditioner, and this is my help to lift it on the roof. This is an old Genie boom lift for picking up a person and maneuvering them around. This can easily pick up an air conditioner. The only problem is, this doesn't work right now, as usual. This actually had computer controls in the electronics that operated everything, and those control boards had gotten wet at some point and they didn't work at all.
This is the bank of solenoids that controls the hydraulics, and these are all 24 volt. I just hooked them to a bunch of extension cords that ran out here, and then up here through that arm.
Cords go to the original control cables that are up in the basket.
Just all these on-off switches to make it do everything.
It also has an electric motor that drives the rear axle.
And there's the 36 volt electric motor that drives the unit and has an automatic disc brake. So if you're not on power, it hits the brakes. There's the drive shaft to a Dana 44 rear axle.
I eliminated the electronic speed control, so I have a low and a high by bypassing resistor or going through the resistor. It has solenoids to switch it, and for some reason they stop going one direction, you can only go one way.
And here are the solenoids that handle driving forward and reverse, and the resistors for the speed control. They do work right now, but I'm somewhat concerned that taking them apart will make things break more than they already have. And right now it does go forward, which is what you need most of the time.
And I have to tow it to go the other way. That was somewhat inconvenient, so I really stopped using this. But now I need to get it working.
And that's where those batteries come in, because this doesn't have any batteries. So I'm going to install those batteries in here first, get this unit up and running to get the air conditioner on, then I'll pull the batteries out of this and put those in the bus.
Just a little bit of debris.
I was worried I wouldn't remember how to hook up those batteries. I wrote myself a diagram when I pulled them out. So we're all set here.
Mix and match the battery ends to make that work before with various types of batteries.
Luckily, I've still got a pretty good assortment of various adapters. Well, that could work.
I actually couldn't find the adapters I need to go from this to that.
Only this one battery needs the top post style. Then I remember the deep cycle battery I already put in the bus. Now this one has both the bolt down and automotive style terminals, so I can hook these straight up. Luckily, these are all going to be in series, so it doesn't matter that it's a different battery. It should work fine. Now, one thing I always disliked about this system, you need 36 volts in order to power the main drive motor. From the negative, we go plus 12, then we go over, we plus another 12 to 24, and then we go from here over to here to get our 36. But if I want 24, I got to come off that line right there, which means I've got to take this jumper wire that goes to the hydraulic system and put that over here into our 24 volt section and not the full 36. Never liked that, but that's the way it's set up. I don't remember what those wires did, so I'm just gonna ignore them and leave them hanging off for now. And it looks like this switch stopped working, which is why I have a jumper wire there to bypass it. So I think everything looks fine right now. Let's see if this thing works.
Main power on, hydraulic power on. Hear a pump running.
The small pump used for automatic braking is the one that's running.
It's not building pressure. Normally the hydraulic pump would run until it built up pressure and shut off, so I'm wondering if we're low on hydraulic fluid. Let's check that next.
Now this is the main hydraulic pump and tank.
Nothing on the stick.
That little motor down there is a disc brake for the drive that automatically stops when you're not driving it. And that needs to be pressurized in order for you to have brakes. So that's the first thing it does.
Yep. Oh, this is gonna have to go slow.
I got fluid all over the tank, including most of it in, so that's good. I'm gonna try main power on, hydraulic power on. That pump is just running and not building up pressure. I'm going to try running the main pump and see if it needs to feed some through to feed that other pump, because I don't see another reservoir.
Hey, it's lifting up. All right. Main pump's working, but that little pump isn't. So I'm going to shut it off again. Because I know that wasn't supposed to run continuously, so I don't want to burn anything out. I know that brake works automatically with the drive system. I'm wondering if maybe the drive needs to actuate in order for fluid to flow through it and that pump to build pressure. Not sure, but I don't see anything obvious that's the problem. So I'm going to try moving it real fast and actually driving it. I think it went that way and didn't go that way. Maybe. I don't remember. Pump just stopped. Something's working.
I managed to get myself completely stuck. I can't go backwards. I can't go forward because this is the electric truck, which doesn't run and has a flat tire. Even if I move that truck, I can't go forward because I'm going to run into the La Forza and that doesn't run. I'm kind of stuck in a spot here. The question is how to get myself out of it. There's the ideal solution. This is the tow tug. It is a super maneuverable four-wheel steering, short wheelbase, super powerful towing vehicle, which is perfect for towing that out of its spot. Except, this thing's leaking hydraulic fluid. So right now, this one doesn't really steer. So the situation I have now is in order to install the air conditioner in that garage onto that bus, I need the man lift that's stuck behind that house. In order to get the man lift out from behind that house, I need the tow tug, which is broken. I'm going to fix this to get that going, to get that lifted, to get it installed on there. Yeah, everything's going perfectly. Now, the oil's been leaking in this area. We have 8 hoses, 2 valves, and a cylinder all right here that all could be leaking. So I've got to figure out where the leak's coming from because everything looks a little bit wet. Now, there's an access hole in the floor that can get to some of it. Here's that valve on the drag link. Various connections there. Everything's soaked. That is definitely hydraulic fluid coming straight through a hose. It's missing most of its rubber.
Looks like by turning the steering wheel, I can get that hose closer to me.
Now I got it right where I can get to it, and it's definitely leaking. So that hose is coming off, and we'll see if we can find a new one. It's mostly intact, but it has a few places that leak, and for a hose, that's kind of important. The smart move would probably be replacing both hoses at the same time, but I'm just gonna worry about the one. Got a new line made, and it's going in. So hopefully this solves most of our problem. Luckily, this is a bigger fill cap, so this'll go faster. If I don't pour it all over everywhere. Oh yeah, we're good now. That took a lot. Make sure the rear steering works. Yep. We're good shape there. Looks like it's fixed. I think we're all set. When I built this hull back here, there's a reason I wanted this fairlead. I didn't just go with the one big roller in the middle. I went with the side rollers too. This is why, because I'm going to be pulling out of there sideways. The cable is going to be going that way on that roller. So these rollers are meant for side pulls. And because of the number of things I have in the way, I knew I was going to have to do a side pull at some point. So that's perfect right now. I'm going to give myself another win for this, just as a bonus win. Haven't even actually accomplished anything yet, but I'm going to go with it. Well, most of the moving's done. I just need to move it back a little bit in order to make the rest of the swing. Problem is I need to go that way. And the tow tug is that way. And you can't push with the cable. I'm gonna see if tightening a lug nut will help. New technique. Rock it with a lug wrench and shove a block under it when it moves. At this point, I realize it would be faster to just fix reverse, but I'm not sure if I have the parts or if the solenoid's gonna break, and I might lose forward. So I'm going with this anyway. Even though this is slow, it'll be quicker than waiting on parts to be shipped through the mail. Access to the vent is a lot easier. And we can also see how bad the seams are too. That moss really did a job on this. Huh. That's a little bit of buildup. We were carrying our own little mini forest. Nice. Huh, another little forest on this side too. Now I'm noticing these heads are covered with a sealant, so I can't actually get a screwdriver there. And it appears the entire vent is glued in. I've got one. I'm coming up with a technique for removing these screws. First, you remove the plant life that's living on them. Then you pry away the goop that's covering them up. Then you take an old screw and dig out the goop that's filling the center. And then you can actually remove the screw. I only have to repeat that process a few times. This old vibratory cutter can get in under the flange where all that silicone is, all the way around that vent, and is cutting through it. Ran out of battery about halfway, so I'm going to charge it and keep going in the morning. Seems about done time now. Went way easier than I expected. You see the inner and outer layer of the roof with a nice big metal brace going through it? This is super sturdy where that metal is. Got a piece of wood block here. This is not as sturdy. Also noticing there's no insulation at all between the layers. That's interesting. This piece from the air conditioner is supposed to be a direct fit into a standard vent opening. Yep, it won't fit. Which means I'm gonna have to enlarge that opening. Which also means I have to saw through the roof without ruining any of this stuff. So I'm thinking some kind of drop cloth is in order here. Got the area covered with some used drop cloths. Rips that are in them. Get a little bit of a double layer. That should be fine. Now I can go ahead and cut all this out and not worry about that stuff. It's raining paint and other stuff. Well, normally I dislike using these because of the jagged edge they leave, but it's cutting way easier. Let me show you what we have going on the roof here. There's braces that go down the entire length of the bus and some that go across right there. So those are the structure of the roof. And you can see where the rivets are, they're going right into the main beams. See that moss buildup under this panel? It looks like the root system actually started peeling up these panels. So I'm gonna need to take out these rivets, take out that stuff underneath, hammer this down, re-rivet it, and then seal everything back up. Now, I'm not 100% sure which is less pleasant. Working on the roof through a hole that I can only fit one arm out of, or going above and hanging off a man lift to get down to the roof. Neither one is particularly fun. I'm not having fun, which means I'm doing it wrong, so I have to do it a different way. Looking at the structure of the roof, I think this is fine to walk on. This is definitely better. And as long as I steam the rivets, it doesn't move at all. This thing's real solid. Now I can really get after this. And then my battery goes dead. Just scrape out all this moss stuff from under here before I make it flat while I still can get to it. They definitely pulled that rivet right out. It's amazing what plant life can do. Hoping these rivets will pop loose. There we go. Those are completely gone. We'll be replacing these. Got the factory's rivets that were broken drilled out, placing those. Okay, now I gotta go back down again to increase the air pressure. Higher air pressure is doing it. Yeah, it's funny, when I came up here, I thought I'd had everything I needed. And this is the third time I've had to come back up. But I'm gonna add a few in between because these aren't as strong as the original solid rivets. That should stay good. Now I just gotta seal it all up from water. In the last video, I asked you guys about roof coatings because I never used anything on something like this. I got a ton of recommendations and I really appreciate that because I got to look at all sorts of different options that have been tried. The one thing that got recommended over and over and over again, far more than anything else, was this stuff. It's a Henry's Tropical Roof Coating, and it's got the picture of an RV on it. Now, I did have to close my eyes at the price tag on this. It is not cheap. And apparently, the store knows it's really valuable, too, because the stuff was locked up in a cage. I guess it's good. This stuff claims it has a lifetime warranty, so hopefully I won't have to do it again. Now, I actually read the instructions, and they said step one is to remove any mildew or anything like that with 50-50 bleach and water solution. Found this lying on the garage floor. It's a professional sprayer. Not an amateur sprayer. So, you know the quality of work I'm doing now. That moss is obviously still attempting to kill this bus by ripping up the panels. You can see a rivet's already broken off. That's quite ingrown under there. So we're gonna get it. There, take that. We're gonna just get everything here. Thank you. I got a comment and suggested I get a turbo nozzle for my pressure washer, and Walmart had them in stock, so I did. Basically what this is a high pressure nozzle, but it spins around in a circle, so basically you have the high pressure blast, but it covers more surface area. It worked great for taking off the top layer. The problem is, it worked great for taking off the top layer. Now I know it's underneath. That was paint before. I can see holes through, a lot of paint flaked off.
I found a big hole here.
Now my original plan was to prep the roof and do the coating before putting the AC on. That way it was all done. But there's a lot more metal work to do. Luckily, I make this stuff up as I go along, so that's not really a big deal. Now I've got the metal right around the air conditioner in good shape. So I'm going to prep and coat just that small area, and that's it. And that way, when I get the rest ready to go, I can just go up to the air conditioner, and everything under it will already be coated. Now, the instructions say to use a chemical detergent, TSP, to prep the surface. I've never used this before, but apparently it's banned in a lot of places. And I wanted to figure out why, because every once in a while, they ban things for a good reason. Apparently, the issue is that if this stuff gets into a stream or a pond, it makes algae grow like crazy. It acts like a fertilizer. But luckily, there are no streams or ponds for miles and miles. I don't need to worry about that. I'm going to coat it down and wash it off and let it dry overnight.
Now it's time to solve the problem of the curvature of the roof.
They're racing. I think that one's faster.
Now I just want to jump in real quick and make sure you don't think I'm endorsing MakerBot. I actually dislike the company. They don't support their old machines, and they're not good on support with parts on new machines. But if you look on eBay right after Christmas, you can pick up these things dirt cheap. So I have them, but I definitely would not buy a new one from this company.
Well, that didn't work out.
That one worked, but warped severely.
I'm gonna put down some high temperature tape on my build plate. Now as the top layer solidifies, it kind of pulls it into a banana shape. So hopefully this will give me a little more adhesion.
Nope, that didn't work. Part's over there. It's not printing it anymore.
And this one seems to have curled more. So that tape's a bad idea.
We'll just shut them both down and try something new.
That doesn't really help anything.
Peel off this tape. Let's give a shot to regular masking tape. Obviously it's not working as is, so we'll try something different.
Now blue tape seems to be holding up a lot better.
Don't see any peeling yet. There's a possibility this might just work.
That blue tape was definitely the trick.
Now both printers are making the same part. This one took 1 hour and 58 minutes. This one took 1 hour and 48 minutes. So, a little faster, but not by a whole lot.
The 3D printed wedges are out. And then, gonna have these strips of aluminum on the sides here. A lot of the weight is gonna be right on this rib, which is where I want it.
Their wood blocks were in here on the vent. They actually filled up this gap up here, so I'm gonna put these back in place because they already fit.
In the rear, there's gonna be 3 foam pads. One's gonna go in the center, right on top of this big strong piece, so that's good. Then I'm gonna put an aluminum block on either side with a long length on it to catch the curved rib that goes across.
Got an old Ziploc with some screws in it and my miscellaneous stainless steel bin. So these will be perfect for attaching those rails.
That's good.
Now I made a little map of the gaskets on the bottom of the AC. We've got the opening there, and then there's 3 little pads that also need to sit on the roof. That center one will sit right in the center line on that big rib. I need a spacer on the other 2. So I gotta put that in place.
I think I got it all in place there. I actually popped for the matching seam sealer. So I'm gonna start at this point and work my way backwards past where the air conditioner is gonna be. Then I'll coat a circle around it. So the way I drop it on top, everything under it will be coated. And I'll worry about the rest after I get all the other metal work done.
All right, that feels pretty dry. Let's do a top coat. See how this stuff does.
I've got the roof area around the AC done.
Well, everything had the drop cloth on it. I took a little of the tack on the ceiling, did some Rust-Oleum white on there with a roller. I didn't have that side tarped, so that'll need to be done soon. But if I look this way, it looks pretty good. Now, I had to take all those drop cloths down because I've got to find out where this wire goes. This is a 12-volt supply from the vent fan, and it goes in here. Now, I know there's a rib here, And I know there's a rib here where those screws go. So that wire has to go here somewhere. There's little filler panels here. I'm hoping I can pop these off and find that wire coming out. It's going to have to drop. I don't know. It's got to come out there somewhere. So I'm going to pull these off next. Now these little buttons look like they're hiding something. There we go. That's how we take it apart. I think these shelves are holding it down. That's how I undo the shelves. There's a lot of rust coming out from under here. Hopefully I can see under enough. Wow, to see a lot more rust. I didn't want to see that. Oh, we have this nice vinyl covered panel here. And under that, we've got this. Looks like it's still structural, but that is definitely rusty. I think I see my yellow wire in there. So I probably could have gotten to it without removing any of this stuff, just by removing that one light. Now I know, and I know what's under there. Picked myself up some 12 gauge wire to run the AC with. It actually wasn't that expensive, $23 for a spool of 25 feet. Now that I know I'm going from here all the way down inside that channel, I'm glad I have 25 feet. So we are just going to, we're going to try to find the end of the tape. How is it that operating the tape is one of the difficult parts of this job? Oh yeah, I'm just ripping into little pieces. So what if it's 20 years old? It should still work, probably. There we go. All right, now I'm covered in tape. I'm going to tape this wire to this wire. Oh, ripped off. Perfect. That's exactly what I wanted to do. And hopefully, it all comes together. And it's stuck. I'm going to shove a bunch of this stuff just in there. Yep, I got it. I don't know how much I'm going to need, so I'm just going to feed the whole spool through. I took a couple pieces of scrap metal and then slung it off the basket here. I'm going to use this to lift it up onto there, nice and gently, without falling, hopefully, I think. Maybe.
Actually, it looks kind of sturdy. All right, up we go.
I could see a little bit. Kinda. Let's go inside and take a look. It's above us. That's good. So it looks like I need to go that way a bit and down a bit, and we're kind of getting somewhere here. I think I'll be able to learn to lift it up and turn it from in here, and that might get it in the final position. The way this unit mounts is there's holes in each corner for a pretty good sized bolt, and those bolts are in this inner plate. This whole thing sandwiches the roof in the middle, and that holds it all in place. Now it looks like you're not supposed to wear your hand here just so you don't damage the foam. So if I just grab metal, it should be okay. I hope. I think I need to be on the outside and do the swiveling now. I wonder how I'm going to get up there without the man lift. I'll try a ladder. I can't actually reach the unit from the ladder, but I think with a stick, I can knock the straps off the man lift, then drive that down, hop in it, come back up, and then lift the unit and reposition it while I'm on the roof. Supports out. We're getting somewhere. A little more wiggling. Now, I'm mounting the inner piece that actually holds the whole unit on, but of course, this can't actually go flush with the roof like it's supposed to. Because of the curvature, not only do I have to have this space down in the middle, but the piece that covers this up is even bigger. So I've got to space the sides down too, so it's down far enough the flat piece that goes across actually clears the edges. So I took some guesses, and I've got some more 3/8 strips of aluminum here, more 3D printed pieces here, and that should fill up the gap there that'll allow me to install that cover piece and everything will clear. We'll tighten it down and find out. And here's with the cover plate installed. There's a little gap on the sides here too. I actually didn't want that to go flush because there is a filter that you have to pull out. So I needed a little gap so I can actually get that to bend and come out of here. I might go back later and print myself a filler piece here. It's really not that bad. You see the gap, but it's not affecting anything. It's just cosmetic. So I'll get to that someday in like 10 years or so. But now we need to turn it on. And that part is easy. I think. There it goes.
So now we'll give it a little while and see what happens. I can already feel cool air coming out. I just hope it's enough.
We're going to repeat the air conditioner test.
In the last video, I tried out the old air conditioner. Outside, it was 77. Inside, it was 75. And the outlet was above 50 degrees. Let's see how the new one compares.
So it is about the same ambient temperature as before. Now let's check inside. It's been running for probably an hour, hour and a half.
And there's our temperature. That is nice.
And that's what it's set for. So I could probably even make it colder if I want to. Now let's check the outlet temperature.
Put that probe in the airstream.
I'm happy with this air conditioner. Now it might be able to handle desert temperature. Hopefully. We'll see when it gets real hot. This thing looks way better than what we had before for air conditioning. So I'm real happy with that upgrade. I'm calling this air conditioner install a win. Because I installed an air conditioner. And it works. I also fixed the tow tug. I got the man lift kind of working. I'll work on that someday, but for now, it's in a perfect position to work on the roof, and I've got more stuff to do on the roof. There's more rivets that need replacing, more ceiling to be done. I'm going to be here for a while, so I'm going to leave that in place and worry about moving the batteries later. I think I had enough fun for this video, so I'm going to call it an end here. Hope you guys are having fun too, and we'll see you next time.